Hello and welcome to The Road Less Taken, presented by Nexus Consulting. In this brand new video series, we are going to introduce you to people who have taken the proverbial road less traveled and made a huge difference to their own lives and in many cases to others' lives as well. My name is Venki Srinivasan. I am the CEO and co-founder of Nexus. And today, I'm going to take you down a journey with a person who has reached the very epitome of his sport, but he's also done something that's far more difficult. He's also helped others reach such similar heights. It is my pleasure and privilege to welcome as the first ever guest on The Road Less Taken, the chief coach of the Indian national badminton team and the former All England badminton singles champion, Pulela Gopichand. Pulela Gopichand, Gopi, hi, wonderful to have you here. Thank you very much for being a part of this show and a very warm welcome to you.
Thanks, Venki.
I'll get into it straight away and take you back right to the beginning. You grew up in quite a few cities when you were very young. I think in Orissa, in Tamil Nadu, in Chennai or Madras as it was called then, and then in Andhra, of course, before you moved into Hyderabad. What is your first memory of picking up a badminton racket? How did you get into this whole obsession, if I might say, of playing sport and badminton?
Well, my father used to play some badminton when we were in Ongole at the collector's bungalow, and it was kind of an outdoor court, which was one court, and there were quite a few of them playing. So we would tag along someday. When he was playing, we would tag along. So that's kind of the first memories. I don't know if I really could hit the shuttle then.
How old then?
I was about eight, nine. So that's when we were in Ongole. Once or twice, I think we got a chance to play badminton in our house in Ongole where we were.
So then you at some point decided to kind of become more active with the sport. I think that happened after you moved from Ongole to Hyderabad and you actually started playing. When you were in school, what are your memories of, I presume you were not the typical school kid in the whole exam race and so on. And you were playing a lot of the time because I remember you were playing right from your under 12 kind of levels.
For me, actually, we were just lucky. I would say that father had a bank job, so he got posted somewhere. We took an apartment which is close to the stadium, not by choice, but just it so happened that there was an apartment which was available. So it was actually Kashyap's apartment which we rented out.
Okay. So it came a full circle later. Okay, very interesting. Yeah. Okay.
So we just were there and I was just playing all kinds of games, mostly cricket and stuff, because it was 84, 85 kind after the World Cup of 83, everyone was. So I was also playing sport. So kind of went to the stadium actually because got trouble at home because I was always playing. I would get hurt myself. I was getting sunstroke. I was, neighbors were complaining because we were all a bunch of kids who were actually noisy and breaking window panes. So kind of mom decided, let me take you to the stadium. So I actually went there to join for cricket. And fortunately, cricket was full.
And so, as is to be expected.
Yeah, cricket was full. And then the next choice was tennis because that's the only sport. Those are the only two sports which we were watching on television or something. We bought a television in 84. Tennis, somehow parents thought it was kind of too expensive to play. There were too many cars parked outside. So went to the badminton court, which was empty. And since my father, my mom's sister had played badminton, we had a couple of people in Connect. So it was badminton. As a 12-year-old, 11-year-old, I was thinking more of, say, cricket and tennis.
Right.
Parents were thought a little deeper, probably expenses, economy and stuff. So they kind of, once it was not cricket, then it was badminton. So school, it was tough because I was kind of not the greatest of students from a class. I was like, okay on the subjects, but to give you a typical example, my brother and me wrote LKG and UKG exams in Chennai.
Right.
He got through to Padma Sheshadri and I didn't. So that continued. So in school also it was the same. So the school, St. Paul's, is a very one of those schools which is very education-wise very good.
Right.
So I and brother wrote the entrance. He got through, I didn't. And then the next year, my brother PK Jose, who was the principal, actually he watched me play badminton and he said, I want to give you an admission in the school because of badminton. So it was kind of 8th class then. So it was from then on, sport was important. So class had clearly two, three demarcations, in the sense there were teachers who were for me totally. Right. Because also I was good in English and socials and stuff because I had this, I was in Chennai and growing in a cosmopolitan kind of an environment. So I could speak good English. But I was in maths and Telugu and stuff. I was really bad because we just moved states and that connect never came. And also
you could actually speak better Tamil than Telugu at one point of time.
I totally could entirely was very good. Tamil movies, Rajinikanth, they're a big fan, all that stuff. So once we came here and in school, I was a favorite of few teachers who loved my sport, who loved my English and the languages and stuff. And there were some who thought I was just wasting time.
Right.
Friends, not much. Because my school interactions was that I would be the last to get into school and the first to get out. That's how my fellow students would remember me.
Right.
So I was like just waiting to go to the badminton court always.
That brings me to the next question that I want to ask. You spoke about your brother your brother, not many people may know that your brother was also a fairly accomplished badminton player, and both of you were going neck on neck at one point of time. You met each other in a age group state final and all of that. And then he kind of, I guess at one point of time when it came to that crossroad, he went down the academic path to IIT Madras and onwards, and you went down the sporting path. So what was it like making the choice for both of you? I mean, and did either of you feel that you missed out on something by taking the other path?
I'm sure my brother is feeling that because he was good in badminton, but he was brilliant in studies because he studied for about 4 months after we finished our junior nationals in November, December. And then he studied for IIT entrance and he got a 101 rank in JEE,
wow,
which is like phenomenal guy. So right. He was brilliant all through. But luckily for me, I wasn't so good in studies because had I been good or decent also, I would have actually gone the engineering route. And yeah. Although having said that, I think I still was 80% in my 10th exams.
Right.
So I wasn't bad from a normal perspective, but I think to get into say the IITs or the Roorkees, I think that was not me. That year was good because I still wrote the entrance exam and luckily for me, I didn't get through. And that made a difference because we're looking at 90s, right? Early 90, 89, 90. And that point of time, I think engineering study in a Telugu family was probably more important, and possibly parents would have had too much of pressure to actually push me through to badminton if I had got that seat in engineering. That's what I think. But luckily for me, that year I took to BA and that was the year I won the junior nationals. And then more importantly, I got a job in Tata Steel. And that's how I started playing. Otherwise, we don't know because badminton in Hyderabad or Telangana or Andhra then didn't have a precedent of people actually doing well internationally. So I really doubt if that year I would have been able to make that choice if it was an equal choice. And I don't regret anything of what has happened. I have never missed my school or college. I've had more than my share of fun on the badminton court.
Right. So that the, you touched upon that interesting point of that of those times that the just about liberalization coming into India and the need for a secure job and a strong degree and so on. And so how much of this choice that you made was supported and backed by your parents, and how important do you think that was?
Well, I had great support from my family in terms of parents and stuff, but I can't say that thing about the entire relatives and friends kind of a scenario. My brother was bullish. He said, this fellow is very good. He should play. Or he was like, this fellow just can't study to that level. Just leave him. Why are you pushing him? So, right. So I think those words were very, very encouraging. Right. My father and mother were very supportive. Having said that, they were also very tough because education was important. It was like you had to study, put in those number of hours. So till 12th, the entire childhood was kind of tough in the sense there was like maybe in a week, there was maybe 15 minutes of television. So I think for somebody who's of this age to actually think back then would be difficult. If your study marks come below a certain level, then you can't play badminton. So it was like I had to study because I had to play. I love to play, so I had to study. So that was the kind of scenario we had during that period of time. People in the relatives, they just weren't sure of what was happening because this guy's wasting time, this guy's playing, what are you trying to do? And one guy is going to be a top engineer, what's this guy going to do? So there were pressures. But luckily, parents defended me. But they also put equal amount of pressure to ensure that I keep studying well.
Right, right. I guess once you started playing, once you got into college, etc., after that, did you ever think of a career outside sport? Did you have like this kind of backup plan in your mind saying, I'm going to try this, I'm going to try my best, I'm going to see where it goes, but if it doesn't work, I'm going to do something else? And is that something at all that one should, an aspiring youngster getting into sport today should think about?
I think the people around him should think about it. And the person who's actually doing it should think that he doesn't have an option. Right. I think that's a good scenario to have. Because for me, the advantage was that I had no backup plan. And that meant that I dived in fully. And I was invested in it fully. So there was no going back in it.
Right.
Especially this was important during, say, 94, when I had an ACL tear.
Right.
And at that point of time, imagine 25 years ago, you didn't have the greatest of rehabs or projects. So you didn't have a precedent of people coming back after an ACL tear. Or if there was a backup plan, or if I was thinking about career, then I probably would have looked around. Right. But luckily, I didn't have. Right. And actually, I just dived in fully. Yeah. Having said that, I think when I plan or when I'm thinking at players today, I would say the player should think he doesn't have an option. But the coach and the family should ensure that there is an option. Because you have to plan for failure. Success will take care of itself.
Wow, that's a terrific point. I think that's a terrific point. And then after this long and arduous journey, you finally hit the pinnacle. You achieved your dream. You won the All England Badminton Championships. I would say quite at a slightly later stage in your career. So that was quite an achievement to do it when you did it in 2001. And then you kind of figured that it was kind of time to hang up your boots and retire from actively playing the sport. When you stood at those crossroads again and at that juncture, was coaching the most natural thing that came to your mind that you should do? Or were there other things that you were weighing up against?
Well, there were two things. One was all my life playing badminton. Would really struggle for very fundamental things. And for me, getting to the badminton court, having a court which is open, which has current, which has clean, which is clean, to have shuttles, to have a coach, to have players, to go to the gym and find it neat and available, to go to the pool and have water, to go to the ground and see it's available. I think these things just took a lot of toll on me growing up, because when I look back at my journey over the years, I just realized that, boss, this is like tough. But what was the best part in my journey was that in spite of all of this, I kind of won the All England and I was kind of playing the top. So I was like, boss, if I can do it, maybe there are many others who can do it. And by kind of in 94, I had a surgery, 96, I had one, 98, I had one. So kind of by the end of it, although I won the All England late, I kind of knew the formula which was needed to win.
Right.
Whether it was my coaches, whether it was my own trial and error method or my travel, I just knew that this is what needs to be done to win. And I had the formula. Unfortunately, I didn't have the body. So the only way I could use the formula was find kids who would actually do it for me. And then the second thing was that I need this infra to be there. So to set up the academy was important. And to get into coaching was important.
Right.
Now, there was a certain segment which actually was quite forceful. And in fact, from the for a couple of my journalist friends were very not in favor of me getting in to the coaching field, because they just feel, what are you doing? In the sense, you've done enough work over the years. It's time to be a critic, to be a commentator. And at that time, there was Star and they were looking for one.
Right.
So he said, why don't you just do that? And we had a couple of international chances to be coaches and stuff. Once there were. So these were the kind of easy options available.
Right.
But as I said, I didn't even give it a thought. Mm. I just was clear what I wanted. Venki, the thing is that whether it was my playing career growing up, or whether it was my injuries, because I remember people would say that if you have an ACL tear on your left knee, then you should take backhands and you should not jump. And if you looked at the way I played, I just went all full throttle. And I was just dive into it. Just went into, I would say, yeah, if it hurts, then I will just go get it another surgery. But this is the way I will play. Mm-hmm. And I will do it every time the same way. So I would just go and jump on the left foot like 10 days after the surgery. And then I was like, come on, let me go for it. So that's the same attitude which I had when I left the sport. Mm-hmm. I just left it quickly. The end result, I just dived into it because I didn't want to hang around there knowing that my best was behind me.
So what drives this DNA of making the hard choice all the time as opposed to the easy choice? You seem to have done it throughout your career, from your childhood. I mean, what drives this? Is this something you think you've acquired from your parents, or is that something that just has come naturally to you? Have there been specific experiences that have molded this?
As far as the career and some of these choices were concerned, I think the gut plays an important role for me. I have to feel good about it. And one such example I can give is, we played a tournament post my second surgery, and I kind of played this match without smashing, with a half smash, with a dribble, and then the classic Indian style.
Right.
And I kind of won the tournament. And that day I just went home and I just said, there's no way I'm going to play badminton like this, in the sense I would rather stop than play this kind of badminton. Even though I had won, I just didn't enjoy the way I had won.
Right.
And I said, this is not me and I cannot do this. So in the same way, I think I remember when started coaching, just went out there. We didn't have funds. We didn't have an academy. We didn't have anything. And I said, I'm going to coach now. And I don't know the first few years, I don't know how much amount of time, money, resources, whatever, just spent it out from my pocket. And there was no thinking about it. In the sense, it was just that I have a formula and it should work. And the same thing with the academy. I said, I want a ground. I want a running track. I want a swimming pool. I want badminton courts. I want rooms. I want gym. I want sport. Everything should be there. And at that point of time, in 2005 to imagine that I'll put up something which is 8 badminton courts and 50, 60 right. accommodations. And right. that was unimaginable. I didn't have neither had the money right. nor the sponsors to.
Right.
But you were going there, but God's been kind. I think right. Whenever right. I've had these diving moments, he has really helped me, pulled me out.
Right. I want to ask you a couple of questions specifically related to the coaching side before we close. There's a famous quote by Arrigo Sacchi of AC Milan, one of the greatest football coaches, who said, "I never realized that to be a jockey, you had to be a horse first." So he was referring to whether, you know, you need to be a very good player to be a very good coach. What is your take on that? Do you think today an aspiring youngster who hasn't made it to the highest level as a player can actually aspire to become a coach?
So when we look at coaches, who are we referring to is an important aspect. Are we looking at grassroots level coaches, intermediate level coaches, or elite coaches? So if you talk to different people, it's different. And different sports also, it's different. And I've been really fortunate. And if I connect the dots of my journey, I've been very fortunate that I had a coach called Hamid Hussain, sir, who didn't teach me great things about the sport in terms of the specifics of how to hold, how to hit, but he made me love the sport. And that was crucial for me. My second coach was Arif, sir, and he was a great disciplinarian. He was very, very important in the structure. So if you're an intermediate coach, I think to have, to make you a workhorse, to be disciplined, to be structured, is very critical. And I was very fortunate to be with Prakash, sir. And to have that inspiration, to have somebody show you that path at a particular juncture in your life is very, very important. So you need those people. And then I was with Ganguly Prasad in the end of my career. And you need a friend whom you can talk to is very right. important. So I think when you're talking about this, I'd say at the elite level, maybe you might just need somebody who will actually be there with you and who can actually be your sounding board, who understands things. And today, maybe it's different from 20 years ago, because today you have a sports science guy, you have a psychologist, you have nutrition, you have guys whom you need to coordinate with. Right. So at an elite level, maybe some coach who can take the pressure off the player would be important. To tell you those specific strategies at the highest level when you need is very important. Because in my career, that is what that has done is it gave me a jump start in the beginning, which was very, very important, because players trusted me blindly. So in those times when players didn't have the belief on themselves, it was very important that they have the belief on the coach.
Right. Right.
And today, if you have players who are looking at Saina and Sindhu and Srikanth and Kashyap and all of them and the doubles players, and then you have the players who are looking up to the seniors and saying they already are coming out with belief. So you need a different mindset now. And I think when you say a coach, to generalize a coach across all spectrums would be difficult. So for me, it helps. But I think it also helps if coaches travel the entire journey either themselves or with somebody. Right. That experience is also good enough.
Right, right. So you are also that rare breed who is a top tier, super successful coach after having been a super successful player. So you've in some sense been used to being in the spotlight, both as a player and then, over the last, I would say, about a decade when you've been a very, very prominent coach. How does a coach, how do you deal with it? And how does a coach in any sport deal with this dichotomy of being in the spotlight versus letting your players who are actually out there and performing, kind of take the arc light, so to say?
Well, I think it's different for different people, different generations, different countries and cultures. So in India, many coaches find it very difficult because the system just overpowers you. So if you're not somebody who is in the spotlight, then somebody needs to really protect you.
Right.
And that would be important. So I think it's important because if a coach is putting his head down and working, he just doesn't have any time for socializing or to actually building his PR in a way to protect himself. Because there will be others who will just do that and manage to push you out because of their PR. So right. It's going to be really tough. So it actually helps to actually have this one. So I'm lucky because I have people in the government, in the federation who've seen me work over the years and who've trusted me. It's not come easily because I've had to go through my own share of issues with people because they won't understand the thought because not many of them understand what world level sport is or what you're aspiring for because you're thinking I want to beat China and Korea and the guy is thinking that I want this guy from my state or this friend of mine
right.
to be part of the team. So I haven't had it easy either because I had to struggle. I had to go through a lot in my life. I wish I have the freedom to do what I want because then we would have probably had 2 times more results than what we've had.
Absolutely. So right at the end, Gopi, I want to not ask you a question, but place a request in front of you. If you had to say 2 lines to a kid today who's aspiring to be a sportsperson and kind of model her or his career upon yours or other successful sports people who have gone down that path, what would you say to that kid? And more importantly, what would you say to that kid, to that kid's parents?
The process is the goal and don't run after the goals. I think be good, be invested, be involved, be loving, be liking what you're doing. And the result is the process itself. So I think it's very important to like what you do and to push in whatever you do.
So like what you do, push in whatever you do. The process itself is really the goal. Don't worry about the goal. Follow the process. Thank you, Gopi, for sharing your journey with us. It's been a pleasure as always. And I know that both our viewers and I will take back several valuable lessons. Thank you very much for spending your time with us today and for being the very special first guest on this show that we have launched. Thank you for your support and for being here.
Thank you.
Remember, folks, the road less traveled isn't the easier option, but it may be the more rewarding and, like Gopi says, the more fun option. We'll be back with more journeys, more people that we talk to, more people you can be inspired by. Write into us. Tell us who you would like to see on the show, what questions you would like to ask future guests. And if you like this video, please share it with your friends and share it with people whom you know. We're trying to drive a message of positivity and fun during these trying times. So this is Venky signing off saying thank you very much and see you again on the next episode of The Road Less Taken.